Audio Renaissance presents Grammar Girl's Quick and Dirty Tips to Clean Up Your Writing by Mignon Fogarty. Read by the author.
Introduction. I'm Mignon Fogarty, the author of Grammar Girl's Quick and Dirty Tips to Clean Up Your Writing. Add shine to your image at work, school, and home. This book came about because I produce an internet audio program, a podcast about language. I've been a writer for more than 15 years, and I love helping people write with confidence and providing memory tricks that make writing easier. Most of the topics in this book come directly from real-life questions that have been submitted by my podcast listeners. Whereas our parents often communicated by telephone, with the availability of email and instant messaging today, we're more likely to communicate by writing. That's why it's more important than ever to clean up your writing. It only takes a few email blunders to ruin your reputation at work if you have a grammar stickler for a boss or a colleague who cares about language. If you're a parent, it's also important that you give your children a good foundation for the writing-intensive world that awaits them. Set a good example by using words correctly when you talk to them, and you'll be giving them a leg up in school and at work. An important note is that this is not a comprehensive writing guide. This book contains a selection of interesting topics, and I've attempted to include many of the most common problems that clutter up people's writing. Everyone should have a dictionary, and most casual writers would also benefit from owning a style guide or a grammar handbook. I know that I reach for reference books at least 10 times a day. But if the explanations and memory tricks in this book help you remember the 24 rules that follow, then you'll be able to avoid the common blotches, save your mental energy for the truly difficult questions in life, and shine at work, school, or home. Part 1, Dirty Words. There are some pairs of words that are frustratingly easy to confuse. Sometimes it's because they sound alike, and sometimes it's because they have similar meanings. More than half of the questions I get from listeners are about these confusing word pairs. I imagine people staring at the computer screen, frozen with fear because they don't know whether to use further or farther, and finally giving up and rewriting the whole sentence to avoid the issue altogether. That's a good way to deal with it if you're unsure, but these confusing word pairs are my favorite topic because it's usually easy to come up with helpful memory tricks. And once you know the right words, you can just say what you want to say instead of going through the contortions to avoid making a choice. Affect versus effect. Every week, someone asks how to remember the difference between effect with an A and effect with an E. These two words were also in the list of top 10 words that people looked up on the website dictionary.com in 2006. So I believe it's fair to say that this is a common point of confusion. The good news is that there are a lot of easy ways to remember the differences. First, I'm going to dispense with the rare definitions and focus on the most common uses. The vast majority of the time, effect with an A is a verb, and effect with an E is a noun. Verbs are actions, and nouns are people, places, or things. I'm going to pronounce them a little strangely in this segment to make the difference between them more clear. Affect means to influence, as in, the weather affected the bus schedule, or when the chairman was arrested, it affected the company's valuation. Or the rain affected Amy's hairdo. Affect can also mean roughly to act in a way that you don't feel, as in, she affected an air of superiority. In all of those examples, something is changing. Affect is an action, it's a verb. Note that affect and action both start with the letter A. Effect has a lot of subtle meanings as a noun, but to me, the meaning a result seems to be at the core of all the definitions. For example, you can say, the effect the weather had was amazing, or the sound effects were amazing, or the rain had no effect on Amy's hairdo, or the trick-or-treaters hid behind the bushes for effect. In all of those examples, effect is a thing. It's a noun. So most of the time, affect with an A is a verb, and effect with an E is a noun. One trick that's true most of the time is that if you put an article such as an or the in front of the word, then you should be using effect because it's a noun. I remember this by remembering that the ends in the letter E and effect starts with the letter E, so the two E's butt up against each other. But for me, the best quick and dirty memory trick for remembering that effect is a verb and effect is a noun is to think of the sentence, the raven flew down the avenue. That helps because raven and avenue both have the letters A, V, E, N in them. And that helps me remember affect verb, effect noun, where the words also start with A-V-E-N. The raven flew down the avenue. A-V-E-N. Affect verb, effect noun. Backward versus backwards, and toward versus towards. When backward and backwards are used to describe verbs in sentences like the children moved backwards and count backward from 1 to 10, backward and backwards are both correct and interchangeable. Many sources say that the S is more common in Britain than in the United States, so you should take into account what the convention is in your country and use backwards in Britain and backwards in the United States. This regional difference is another reason you're probably confused. If you read the New York Times and the BBC websites in the same day, you could see the word used both ways. The exception is that when you use backward as an adjective, in other words, to describe a noun, as in her grandmother's backward ways, or the program had backward compatibility, then you never use the S. It's always backward as an adjective. So if you're in the United States, you have it easier because you can just remember that it's always backward without the S. We like shortcuts here, like drive-through restaurants, so you can remember that we've lopped off the S. But if you're using British English, then you have to remember that it's backwards as an adverb and backward as an adjective. The story is similar for the words toward and towards. Both are correct and interchangeable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.